I'm trying to put you in the worst mood. P1 cleaner than your church shoes.
Hey, the title's clickbait, but it's not really clickbait at the same time. Let me explain. Roll it. Now, before we get on into the title of the video and why it's right and wrong at the same time, I gotta give the EXO fam portion of the Third Fam my commentary on everything that we just witnessed last night. And if I'm being completely honest, I was excited for halftime. Like, I was already excited for it, but the halftime show ended up being the only thing that was exciting about the game. The game was mid. Tom Brady's the GOAT, we know, obviously. Patrick Mahomes, he did things that a lot of quarterbacks cannot do with the pressure that he had on him. Drop passes, you know, no offensive line. Two of his main components of his line were out, so the whole line was makeshift, people playing in positions that they don't normally play. You know, not making excuses. He took the L, and an L's an L. He's going to wear it like a badge of honor, but that don't make him any less of a quarterback. But I am convinced, based off the performance that I saw from Tom Brady, that he's coming back for another year. Why would he not? But I digress. We're not here to give sports commentary. We're not here to talk about that. We're also not here to talk about the completely mid-level, below average. The commercials were awful this year, but the performance that our boy Abel put on, immaculate. The only thing that I wish during the performance was that his voice was a little louder, the microphone was a little bit louder, but that's not really even his fault. But let's break it down real quick. Let me tell you what was going through my mind song by song from the very intro. That intro where he was in the car inside Las Vegas Boulevard, like the Welcome to Las Vegas sign, and then the camera pans around and we see that it's all broken pieces and he's not really in it. He's like, that intro was amazing. And I'm not even talking about like being a fan of The Weeknd, just being a fan of knowing how forced perspective and being a fan of how camera tricks work. Like, that's something that a lot of people aren't even gonna realize the technical difficulty it is to pull that off. And then we go right from that, he gets down on the stage, and then we have Call Out My Name with basically like this big ass church choir behind it and like singing it really deep. I got chills, son. I got chills from that. And the main reason is because, like, obviously Call Out My Name was an extremely powerful song. It was like a whole new turn that we had never seen from Abel before. He was never that vulnerable type. His lyrics were about fucking bitches over and them not fucking him over. And that was the first time that we had heard him be like, call out my name. I need you to tell me you love me even though I know you don't love me. I was not expecting this song to be in the Super Bowl performance. I basically called almost every single one of these songs except for Blinding Lights. I mean, except for House of Balloons, and we'll get to that. But I was not expecting Call Out My Name to open it. And then the transition from that right into Starboy, and the way he came out in the middle of the stage, like it was all blue, it was dark, it was very ominous, it was very like, why is this so dark and ominous right now? I feel uncomfortable. But then the stage opens up and we get him walking out of the blinding lights of like in from the music video, yo. And then the color scheme, the blue and yellow, perfect. Perfect. So not only do we come in with like the first song from Starboy, the album that basically made us like, damn, he is a Starboy, P1 cleaner than his church shoes, but we go straight into The Hills, which was like, yo, The Hills opening, that whole instrumental build from the beginning of The Hills, the wah, wah, and then it goes down and then all the way up into the fucking hook. Yo, it is an iconic piece of music. And not only is it that, but it was like very aggressive with the choir backing the entire arrangement. Yo, fire. And The Hills is a very important moment in The Weeknd's career because of the fact that that song, to me, it was not written for the radio. It was not written to blow up in the way it did. It had classic like Weeknd mixtape sound, so EXO fam was gonna fuck with it, but then it just like rose to the top of the charts. Like, yo, a big moment in his career. So then we go obviously from that moment, like the rise in The Hills, but then we go to I Can't Feel My Face, which was really his first mainstream successful track, was that track. And again, this is why in his songs, he's like, I'm winning Teen Choice Awards for songs where I'm talking about doing cocaine. The whole song is about cocaine. I can't feel my face when I'm with you. because our face is numb off of a bag of blow, but I love it. And people still to this day do not realize that's what the song is about. But yo, him going into the back, like underground, like behind the set, and in that like mirror, that hall of mirrors, and it looked like Blinding Lights set, and all of the different weekends running around, it just felt so hectic and so like it was fun. It was a dope ass portion of the performance, because that part of the performance is just as fun as the actual song is. The song is hectic and crazy and all the different things going on in the song, and it's just like you fall in love with that tight with that lifestyle. That's what it's about. I can't feel my face when I'm with you, but I love it. And I know she'll be the death of me, but at least we'll both be numb. But to go from that hella fast-paced track right on into I Feel It Coming, that sonic transition from one track to the next, oh, chills again, dog. Now, I'm not gonna lie, one thing that it wasn't necessarily a disappointment, because I was getting my hopes way the hell up there, but I was like, it would be fire if he brought Daft Punk out with this track, like, just as a cameo. I knew that it was like a long shot of that happening, but that would have been dope. But yo, yeah, just the visual transition of him being in that crowded ass room with all that hecticness, and then he goes right into the song with Daft Punk, and it's such a chill, such a like a way like subdued vibe coming from that, and then he walks out and he's like above the entire stadium. Just dope, visually and audibly. And then he goes right into Save My Tears, which is also like the acoustic guitar coming in, and then the actual dude playing the guitar had the mask that is in the music video. Like, you're not gonna know that. You're not gonna know those little like Easter egg moments unless you're someone who is devoted or who loves The Weeknd in the way the EXO fam does. I was there in my house with everybody watching, and I was literally the only one that saw the mask and was like, yo, that's the mask from the video. That's cause I'm the only one that's EXO like that. You know what I'm saying? And then obviously we knew he was gonna play Earned It. There's no way that he didn't. Another song that put him on the map because it was the 50 Shades of Grey basically theme song for the entire trilogy. A certified hood classic, that song is. And then we had like that little vocal, like that vocal like stepping up into the notes and doing it again and holding that highest note until the very end of the song, and then everything goes black with just a spotlight like silhouetting him. Fire. But all of that, everything that I had predicted was coming true so far, and it was exactly as I had predicted it. Down to like the song list, maybe not the order, but I was expecting all of these songs in the way that they were, and I knew that we were coming to the end of the performance, and I was like, there's no way he doesn't do Blinding Lights. That has to be the next song. But there was no way that my mind was ever gonna be fucking prepared for House of Balloons off of his very first mixtape. There was no way I was prepared for that song to come in, especially the part that it did with like that very like militant style sound to it, and it's very like, it's just so marching, and it's like a chant the way that it came in. And then we literally had all the Weeknds on the field marching, like, yo, I was ecstatic. I was so not ready for that to come in like that. And then after that, he transitions from that song into Blinding Lights. And as I was watching the performance, it was at that moment when I realized exactly what was happening and exactly why the end of this Super Bowl show was happening in the way it was. It wasn't until this moment that I realized that he's not doing it for anybody but the EXO fam, but his fan base. And I felt extremely prideful in that second, in that 2 minutes of the performance, because I was like, I was here watching The Weeknd develop from the very beginning. Just like a lot of you fam who are watching this video right now, you saw The Weeknd grow up in front of your eyes. We have the title track from his very first mixtape, a track that 10 years ago, whenever he wrote it and when the mixtapes were out and were kind of just barely popping off a little bit, and when we found him, that he was an entirely different person at that point. His first mixtape, his first tour, he was scared to show the world his face. Any video that you had ever run across on YouTube was always just like a picture of the album artwork and him singing. We never saw his face. He was scared and anxious and had severe stage fright. Right, to even step on stage, which is why he never toured during the House of Balloons time. He was literally an enigma to the select few that I am a part of that found him when he was nobody. I saw him live on his first tour ever in Austin, Texas at Austin Music Hall with like maybe 2,500 other people. He had no stage presence. He did not have the vocal control that is required for an amazing live performance at that time, but you could see the star power that was right in front of our eyes. It was literally like finding a diamond in the rough. So I saw him go from that all the way to the fucking Super Bowl. literally the biggest stage in the world, where only a select few artists are even capable of saying that they had the ability to perform during Super Bowl. I saw him go from nobody scared to be on stage to fucking Super Bowl. I was there during that entire transition, and that's when the moment in my head, that's when I was like, yo, I understand now. He ended the performance with his very first song on his very first mixtape title track, all the way to performing the biggest single in the modern streaming era, breaking all kinds of records, breaking the Billboard 100 for like the amount of weeks that it was on, a record that was held for like 56 years or something. And it was in that moment that I realized, like, yo, no one is gonna know the House of Balloons song except for the people that have been rocking with him from the very beginning. So I said all of that because I wanted to bring up the point that Tyler McCarthy, whoever you are who wrote this, the weekend Super Bowl halftime show underwhelms viewers for Fox News. I'm saying all that to basically say to this person and everybody else who feels like that, exactly why you are correct and why you are incorrect at the same time. The reason you are correct is because it was not a traditional halftime show. It wasn't a show in front of 130,000 people in the stadium. It was a show in front of 20, which means that The Weeknd was not performing a traditional performance to people in the crowd. He actually made the performance designed for people to be watched at home. This is why he's looking into the camera all the time. This is why he's able to move backstage and come forward and all of that. It was not your traditional halftime performance, and to be honest, I preferred it that way because it allowed us to connect with him as the artist and his fan base. The second reason why you might have thought it was boring is because you know nothing about the artist. As I was looking for the blinding light stats, I searched on Google, and the first three articles that popped up from Variety or from Vox or whatever the hell, they were like a rundown of who The Weeknd is, and that's when I was like, it wasn't for you. He was not performing for you. He was performing for us. Anybody that says that this performance was boring is probably the same person that says, who is The Weeknd? It's probably the same person that says, why did he do that to his face? It's probably the same person that says, why does he keep wearing the same outfit over and over? You just don't know everything that went into it, and you don't know everything. You don't know anything about the artist. Because if you did, you would understand that this was a theatrical performance and not necessarily a musical performance, I guess you could say. He was performing for us at the Super Bowl. It wasn't The Weeknd performing for Super Bowl halftime. He took that stage, which happens to be the largest stage in the world, and he made sure that the performance didn't get lost for his fans. That's the reason why After Hours was released during the pandemic, even though we know that there was gonna be no tour. Artists don't make money on the actual albums, they make money on the tour, but he said, fuck it, I don't care. My fans have been waiting, we're putting the album out, we'll tour whenever we have to. And I don't know if it's an unfortunate thing for you, Tyler, and all the people who have that mentality, or if it's a fortunate thing for us that we know we don't take for granted, but I seriously doubt there has ever been an artist that has performed at the Super Bowl that you liked that cared about you as a fan in the same way that The Weeknd cares about his fan base. And that reason alone is why you found it boring, and while you might be correct, it was also not boring, and that is more correct. At the end of the day, The Weeknd is not doing it for the publicity. The Weeknd does not care about the fame. He, to the point where he didn't even want to be a mainstream artist. The whole song, Rolling Stone, is about him having to turn, is about him being scared. It's a double entendre for one, the love of his life, or the love in the song, but also the love is his fan base. He didn't want to lose his dedicated fan base who loves his sound to go mainstream because he knew there was a chance he was going to have to water it down for success. So it is not about the accolades or the fame. It's not about the money. The dude blew $7 million for this 14-minute performance for us. He is literally about his fan base. And that is why the performance was everything that any of us had ever envisioned. And that's why his fan base loves it in the way that we do. And that's all there is to it. The Weeknd to us, EXO fam, via his song Rolling Stone. So baby, love me. Before they all love me, until you won't love me because they all left me. I'll be different, but I hope I'm not different, and I hope you still listen. But until then, I got you.